Hello, this is John Schaap and welcome to this first video in the fully updated 2021 version of AOS 8 video series. I've published similar videos about 3 years ago and those were based on AOS 8.2. We'll now use the latest AOS version, which is 8.9.0.0. Many things have changed over those 3 years, so that is why a new 2021 version is published in the coming months. So first let's go over the terminology changes that have happened over the last years. And what used to be known as Mobility Master is now called a Mobility Conductor or MCR. MCRs are available either as physical or virtual device. Managed devices are controllers and they are also available either as physical or virtual device. Other terms that we do not use anymore is white and blacklist, and we now use allow list and deny list for that. Now, I've used those terms for the last 17 years, so I probably will make some mistakes here in the upcoming videos. In this first video, we are going to look at deploying a standalone virtual mobility controller in VMware ESXi. So, details about the mobility conductor, or MCR, will be in the next videos. VMCs are available in 4 different models, ranging from 10 to 1000 APs, and from 256 to 16K clients. This slide shows which features are supported and which are not when you use AOS 8 without a mobility conductor. You will not have access to all new AOS 8 features in this mode, so that is why it's not deployed that much. Preferred mode for AOS 8 is using managed devices with a mobility conductor. Licenses are needed when you want to deploy an AOS 8 solution, and you have to contact your local Aruba representative if you want to get trial licenses or purchase them. You cannot ask me or anyone else on this channel to give you trial licenses. The licenses which are written in red are the most used ones. The other ones are only used in very special cases where there is a need for that functionality. So for this video we are going to deploy a standalone virtual mobility controller, so I need a license for MCVA and also an AP, PEF and RFP license. A VMC will have 4 network adapters in VMware, and those interfaces link to the interface names on the VMC. In my setup, I'm just going to use interface Gigabit Ethernet 0/0/0, which is highlighted in red. So let's go ahead and install the VMC on VMware ESXi, and let's see how that's done. Log into vSphere and click on Virtual Machines and create Register VM. Deploy an OVF, find the file and drop it in there, and then we're going to give it a name. And in this case we're going to call it VMC Standalone, because that's what it is. Then, next, what you do is select your storage and deployment options, make sure that disk provisioning is set to thick, and select your correct network settings. Click Next and then click Finish. Wait until the installation is done and then go to the network settings and make sure that the port group that you're going to use has promiscuous mode, forwards transmit and MAC address changes set to accept. If you don't do that, you will have issues with configuring redundancy later on, and also L2 Wi-Fi clients that terminate on the VMC will have issues. Last thing we need to check is going to edit the settings of the virtual machine and make sure that reserve all guest memory is checked. Power up the VM for the first time and select Open Console in a new tab to see what is happening during the boot. You see that it's going to boot AOS version 8.9, and this initial boot can take some time depending on the VMware server that you use. I've edited the video to speed things up. At the end of the boot, you will see that the auto-provisioning process is starting, and for this setup we will not use auto-provisioning, so type full setup to start the initial setup procedure. Give the system a name, in this case we're going to call it VMC Standalone. It's a type standalone, it's not a managed device. A controller VLAN is 202 in my case, I'm using this gigabit Ethernet port, and the port is set for trunk mode. Native VLAN IP address on VLAN 202. So that is 10.10.202.20. Subnet mask and the gateway. DNS IP address. If you want IPv6, yes or no. The country code, so where is this controller deployed. The time zone, in my case Europe Amsterdam. And then check the time, check the date. Set a password for console login. And then say yes to accept the changes. And this will initiate a reboot of the controller. Now that the initial configuration has been done, we can open a web browser and connect to the IP address of the VMC. Username is admin and a password is what we have just set during the initial setup procedure. Because we now look at a standalone controller, we only have a folder named Mobility Controller and a device named VMC Standalone. And configuration is hierarchical, so whatever is configured in the folder Mobility Controller flows down into the device named VMC Standalone. In the CLI, these are known as /mm and /mm/mynode. The licenses need to be added to the Mobility Controller, so make sure that Mobility Controller is highlighted. Click the plus sign in inventory, and that's where you will find the license passphrase. The passphrase is needed to activate the license in Aruba support portal. So copy it from here and then go to the support portal. That's where you will find the licenses, and you need to activate the platform license first before any other. So that's what we're going to do here. So copy the passphrase and give it a name so that you can remember what you used it for. Click activate and copy the activation key from the support portal into the field that you see here and click OK. You see now that one license has been activated, and that's the platform license. So now we're going to go back to the support portal and activate the three other remaining licenses. Give the quantity that you want from them. These are 10 AP licenses, 10 PEF and 10 RFP. And the same procedure here, just copy them in. First, copy the passphrase, give it a name again. And then copy the three activation keys from the support portal to the Mobility Controller, one by one. Very important, some of these features, they have a feature bit that you need to enable. If you do not enable the feature bit, the license is in, but it's not enabled, so it will not work. So whenever this pop-up shows enable features, click it so that the feature bit is enabled. And that's only for certain licenses, not all of them have it, as you can see here. In this case, the RFP and the PEF license, they have these feature bits. And after you've copied all four licenses, you click pending changes and you save them, and then you can go to usage, and that's where you see if the feature is enabled. So if you clicked that feature bit correctly, and also which licenses are there and how many you have installed. So you see 10 AP, 10 PEF, 10 RF protect and 1000 total platform limit. And you see how many are available and how many licenses are remaining. Now that the VMC has all the licenses, it's time to bring up our first access point. Campus IPs can discover the controller either via DHCP option 43, via DNS, Aruba-master, or via the Aruba Discovery Protocol. What you see here is the output of the console of an access point, and you see with the red arrows that it got an IP address and also that it found the controller or conductor with IP address 10.10.202.20. When the IP connects to the controller for the first time, you will see that it is seen by the controller, but it is in the denied state because control plane security is enabled, but auto-provisioning of certificates is disabled. So this is what you see here. You can click on access point and you see that it is down. And you can also click on alerts and that will tell you that there is one unapproved IP. Click on it, select it, and then give it a name. Put it in an AP group. Put in the default group here. And also say status accepted and approve. Once you've done that, then it will issue a certificate to the access point, and that certificate will be used after reboot to connect to the controller. If you do show AP database on the command line interface, you will also see that the status is denied. So the AP is not allowed to connect to the controller. So for the rest, we're going to check the system and check if the basic info is set okay, if the country code is set correctly, if your clock is set correctly using NTP, and also if DNS is configured properly. If that all is done correctly, then you can go to CPSec. That's the other way of allowing APs to connect. You can either disable CPSec completely, then there's no certificate needed to connect to the controller, or you can enable auto cert provisioning that you see here, and then the certificate will automatically be placed on the AP. For the rest, we're going to add some VLANs. So we need two VLANs, one for the employee SSID, it's going to be VLAN 211, and another VLAN for the guest SSID, and that's going to be VLAN 212. And again, don't forget to submit pending changes, otherwise the config changes are not done at the controller. So you always, when you change something, you have to hit pending changes to make them active. What else are we going to do? In services firewall, we are going to enable two things. That is firewall visibility and deep packet inspection. That gives us more visibility into the traffic of the Wi-Fi clients. So you have to enable that before you can use that. And that's done here. And then we're going to configure the wireless LANs that we need. So the first one that we're going to configure is the guest wireless LAN. So give it a name. Type is guest. The rest stays default. The VLAN is the VLAN that we configured previously. So the guest VLAN. And the captive portal, I'm going to use a simple one without authentication or registration, just an internal portal that is running on the VMC. And then click next, and a default role will be assigned to the guest users. That's all done automatically. So the first wireless LAN is created. You can see that here, and you can also see that it is broadcasted in the default AP group. Next one is employee wireless LAN, employee type. Next, put it in the right VLAN. Next, then select WPA2 Enterprise. And you have to add a radius server because it is 802.x. So you need a radius server. I'm going to use ClearPass for that. So my ClearPass server is running at 10.10.200.100. Put the shared key in there. Communicate with ClearPass, submit, and the rest is default, next, and then the default role, that's the role after successful authentication. That role can either be statically configured on the controller, or you can send it back from ClearPass to the controller if you want to do it dynamically. Deploy. And then if you click on wireless LAN again, you will see that there are two wireless LANs now. One employee wireless LAN and one guest wireless LAN. What else do we need to do? In authentication advanced, Radius client, we want to set the source interface for Radius packets, because you have to set that in your Radius server that it comes from this IP address. So that's what I do here, that it always uses VLAN 202 as source IP address for any Radius communication. Because the guest VLAN is a layer 3 VLAN, you also have to put an IP address on a layer 3 VLAN. So put a static IP address on there, because captive portal is a layer 3 protocol and it needs an IP address. It cannot be layer 2. So the employee one is layer 2 and the guest one is a layer 3. And in the meantime, our access point has rebooted, and you can see right now it is operating mode campus. It has two wireless LANs configured, two clients connected, so everything looks good. The two clients you see here, one is the employee and one is the guest. One is in VLAN 211, the other one is in VLAN 212. So let's have a look at the AP database on the command line interface. You'll see now that the AP is up and it has a flag 2. That means that it's using IKE version 2. So it's using certificates to authenticate. Other thing that you can do here is show AP BSS table. That shows you which SSIDs are being broadcasted. So we have one access point with two radios and two SSIDs per radio. So that's 4 in total that you can see here. And also what you can do is show user table to see which users are connected, and you will see that the guest and the wireless, where the employee user, are both connected. And you can also check the role where they are in here and also how they are authenticated. This brings us to the end of this first video, so keep an eye out for the next video, which will be posted next Monday, where I will show you how to install and configure mobility conductors and a cluster of controllers. So don't miss it, and please subscribe, like, and let me know in the comments what else you would want to see on iOS 8. Bye for now.